NCBC and friends, last time together. We completed our discussion of the filling of the Holy Spirit. And we said to be filled with the Spirit, with the Holy Spirit, is to be controlled by the Spirit, so that we might accomplish God's will and obey God's word. Our text, of course, was Ephesians 5:18, be not drunk with wine, which is within which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit of God. And there is both comparison and contrast there. There is the comparison in that the man who's filled, who's drunk with wine, is controlled by it, so that that's the same idea of the person who's filled with the Holy Spirit, they're controlled by the Spirit. And then there, of course, is contrast, because the contrast is you don't want to be controlled by something like alcohol or wine or drugs or anything like that, but you want to be controlled as a Christian by the Spirit of God. And so God has given us the Spirit, and we talked about the things that the Spirit of God does to us at the moment of salvation: regeneration, indwelling, baptism, sealing, and anointing us. And now, going forward, those all take place at the moment of salvation. Those all are one-time occurrences with lasting effects. But the filling is something that is to be repeated throughout our Christian walk. And of course, the filling of the Spirit is interrupted because you and I still sin. And so we repeatedly need to be filled. We saw in Acts chapter 2 that the apostles were filled. Peter stood up and preached the first gospel message in the church age in chapter 2. And then we saw in chapter 4 that Peter was again filled with Spirit so he could speak to the Jewish leadership, and he challenged them by saying, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And of course, that's the name of Jesus. And and as you go throughout the book of Acts, you will see that God was filling his servants so that they could proclaim the gospel, that they could be the witnesses that Jesus had instructed them to be in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. And that still is applicable to you and I today. God wants to fill us so that we can speak forth his truth to others. And then God gets the glory as he brings people out of the darkness into the light through the gospel that is proclaimed to them, shared to them, as we witness to them. Because it's not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. So it's not our strength that we're to witness in, it's in the power of the Holy Spirit being under his control. Today we want to turn our attention to the gifts of the Spirit. Now, this is an important topic for every believer to consider and to understand. It is also a very major doctrine with significant implications for the life, health, and the ministry of the church. It's a very broad subject and topic, and we're certainly not going to be able to capture everything today in a single message, but just want to talk about it and overview it and point out some things with regard to it. So today I want to discuss the gifts of the Spirit. We want to look as a scriptural basis, 1 Corinthians 12, so you can turn there in your Bible, 1 Corinthians 12. I'm going to read verses 1 through 11. You see the insert that Teresa did for us in the bulletin, and using these three points, defined, denoted, and distributed, to talk about this topic, the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Help me now as I preach your word. Help us to understand this important subject and what it means for us as individuals, but more importantly, what it means for us as members of New Carrollton Bible Church. And I pray that what you intend for us to understand and learn, we would, and that we would demonstrate that we have learned the lesson because we respond to your truth by doing what you have instructed. So bless each one here, and we pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, 1 Corinthians 12, 1 through 11. Been reading this passage all week long, and so let me read it into your hearing right now. And I'm reading from the New King James Version. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away through these dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. Amen. Looking for something, and all right. Well, I'll move right along. Under point one, defined just a brief overview. Paul wrote to the Corinthians. This was one of the churches he founded on his missionary journeys. You can read about that in Acts chapter 18. He spent about a year and a half in this church. Interestingly, Ephesus and Corinth, he spent the longest periods of his missionary journeys. I think Ephesus was 2 to 3 years, and Corinthians was 18 months, a year and a half. And this is one of the two churches that received two letters from Paul, along with Thessalonica. This church also received two letters. But unlike Thessalonica, this church had a lot of problems. And so what we find is in chapter 1, if you flip over there real quick, Paul had been told about the issues going on there. If you look at verses 10 and 11, he says, "Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus, that you all speak the same thing and that there be no divisions among you." Well, he's saying that there be no divisions because there were divisions. "But that you may be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. For it has been declared to me concerning you, my brethren, by those of Chloe's household, that there are contentions among you." So there was divisiveness in this church, and of course many of you are familiar with the book of 1 Corinthians. They had a lot of problems, and so of the 13, the 9 letters that Paul wrote to 7 churches, Corinth got 2, and they got 2 long letters because they had some real serious problems in this church. So this letter is written to address problems in the church. But not only is it written to address problems, It was also written to answer questions that they have. So just run through it with me real quick. Look at chapter 7, verse 1. Paul says, now concerning the things of which you, what?
You wrote to me.
So he's addressing problems because he's heard about that from Chloe, but they also wrote to him, and so he's going to address some questions that they had. And so he does that about marriage and sexuality in chapter 7. The issue of how to interact with a virgin, look at verse 25 of chapter 7. Now concerning virgins. And so he goes on for the rest of the chapter to discuss that issue with them. Turn to chapter 8. Now concerning things offered to idols. And so he goes on to talk to them about that issue. Chapter 11 was an issue problem. He says, now I praise you, brethren, that you remember me in things and kept the traditions as I delivered them to you. And then 17, now in giving these instructions, I do not praise you. So in verse 2, he was praising them. Now you get to verse 11, he says, I don't praise you now. Then he has to talk to them about the conduct at the Lord's Supper. And then you come to chapter 12, and what does it say? Now concerning spiritual gifts, most versions say, right? And then if you go over to, let's see. He doesn't say now in 15, but 15 is a discussion, all of 15 is a discussion of resurrection and various issues related to it. But then the last, now in chapter 16, one some people don't like to talk about in church. What does it say? Now concerning the collection for the saints, money, all right? Very practical and very spiritual. The gospel is free, but churches operate because there's money coming in. And you have to be faithful in giving in order for the ministry to keep going. All right? So, this was one of the questions. And what you want to see back to 12:1? He says, now concerning, or your English translation, now concerning spiritual gifts, right? Is that what your verse says? But actually the word gift there is italicized, is it not?
Yes.
Which means it's supplied by the translator. It's not in the original Greek. But they supplied it because as you look at this chapter and the following chapters, the issue he's talking about are spiritual gifts. So the Greek word here really is spirituals, or things pertaining to the Spirit. And the same thing happens over in chapter 14, if you turn there real quick. Look at 14:1. You should see the same thing. It says, pursue love and desire, spiritual, and gifts should be italicized. So the same Greek word in 1 Corinthians 12:1 is the same one in 14:1. And I tried to practice pronouncing it last night. But pneuma is the word for spirit, and it's a form of that. And so it's spirituals, or the things that pertain to the Spirit. But charisma, which is the word for gift, that's used throughout this chapter. Yeah, I found it now. Look at verse 4, where you see the word gifts. And then you see the word gifts again in verse 9. And it's... in other places throughout this chapter. So that's why when it was translated into English, most translators translate it the way you have it in your English version, now concerning spiritual gifts. But in the Greek, as I said, it's the spirituals, that which, and it's a plural, so it's spirituals, that which pertains to the Spirit. That's just a little overview of the book. Now, in verse 1, Paul says, I do not, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. Right? So Paul informs the Corinthians that he did not want them to be ignorant about spiritual gifts. So let me define spiritual gifts for you. There are many definitions that are out there, but the one I've used over the last 30 years is that a spiritual gift, and it's a very simple definition, it's a God-given ability for service. A spiritual gift is a God-given ability for service. And if I remember correctly, John, I think this was Dr. Edwards' definition. That's probably why it stuck with me so many years, because of course he was my Greek professor in seminary. But a God-given ability for service. Now let's talk about that for a moment. And I want to make a couple of statements about that. Spiritual gift is a God-given ability for service. So the first thing we know is that it is God-given. It's an ability. And it is given for the purpose of service. This was one of the problems in the Corinthian church. They were using the gifts and abusing the gifts for self-aggrandizement. It was about helping them to be recognized, known, seen, and put forth. But spiritual gifts are God-given abilities for service. That's directed out from you. That's not bringing it to you. It's directed towards others. And we need to also understand that spiritual gifts are not natural talents. Natural talents are what you receive at the moment of birth. And as you go along through your life, you develop them. All right? Now, it's not in this text, but spiritual gifts, one of the spiritual gifts is the gift of encouragement. All right? Singing is not a spiritual gift. All right? Now, Carolyn can sing. Signe can sing, and I mean more than what I can do, okay? I make a joyful noise, but they sing, but that's not a spiritual gift. They, and I know for Carolyn, and it's probably true for Signe as well, they have the gift of encouragement, and they use that natural talent, and the gift flows through that to encourage people. The gift is encouragement, not singing. But the natural talent is singing. Everybody has natural talents. Everybody has a spiritual gift. Every believer has at least one spiritual gift. And you get it at the moment of salvation. Because spiritual gifts are given at the time you're saved and when you receive the Holy Spirit. That's why we spent those lessons talking about what happens when you get saved. And making the point that when you get saved, you receive the Spirit. So that what the Spirit, when you receive the Spirit, you get all of the Spirit. You don't get Him in pieces because He's a person. And when somebody comes visit your house, they don't come in pieces. They come in a whole. And what goes along with them. So at the moment of salvation, you receive the Holy Spirit, ribs, and the spiritual gift or gifts that you have. Now I have the gift of teaching. Hope somebody say amen.
Yes.
You don't like the guy who's running down the street. I got the gift of teaching, and it was a whole group of people following him saying, no he don't, no he don't, no he don't. Okay. Now, I'm pretty positive about that after 40 years of teaching the Bible. Alright? But I'm not too sure about others, and there's some debate about as we get into the gifts, and we don't have time to discuss them totally and fully, but some of the gifts are described and diagnosed in different ways, and we'll talk about that a little bit more, I may save this for another time, but one of the things you need to understand about spiritual gifts, and they're categorized in different ways. I've seen different categorizations, but the one I basically use is that there are serving gifts, there's speaking gifts, and there are sign gifts. All right? And my position is that the sign gifts were temporary and are not operative today. I think our church constitution stays the same, which is one of the reasons why I could come here and pastor this church, because I was in agreement with that. And of course, there are those who do not hold to that. And I'm not going to go too much further into that, and I think that would be a basis of another message. But understand that there are those who say that there are gifts that were practiced in the beginning of the church that are still going on today, and there are those who say that there were certain gifts practiced then that are not going on today. We would fall into that category as a church. I would as an individual, and we would as a church from our doctrinal statement. But speaking gifts, serving gifts, sign gifts are ways in which they are categorized. But the point I want to make to you is that spiritual gifts are received at the moment of salvation. A gift like teaching can be developed. And there's some maturation that takes place with certain of gifts. And of course, you become proficient in using your gift the more often you use your gift. I'm a better teacher today, I think, than I was 40 years ago when I first started out. There are ways to develop it. And now those are other discussions and conversations which I won't delve too far into today. But I just want to make sure you get this, that spiritual gifts are God-given abilities for service. They're not natural talents. They're given to you at the moment of salvation, and they are given for the purpose of service. That's the key point. Well, in verses 2 to 3, Paul teaches the Corinthians and us that a person with the Spirit of God will not curse Jesus, and only a person with the Spirit of God will acknowledge Jesus as Lord. You see, the Corinthians came out of pagan worship, and they were being influenced by false teachers who claimed that their visions, revelations, and messages were from God. And some of these pseudo-Christians would have been in the services, and they thought it was proper and okay to curse God, curse Jesus. You see, one of the first heresies about Christ is the reverse of today. And John addresses it in 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 to 3. There were people who were saying Jesus was not a real man. And so the heresy, that the first Christological heresy to be dealt with in the church age, was not the denial of his deity, which is what we deal with today. Groups like Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons who deny his deity. And of course, all non-Christian religions deny the deity of Christ. The problem back then, at least the start, was they denied that he was human. So it was a heresy called doceticism. And the word dokeo in the Greek means to appear or to seem. So they said he appeared to be a man, but he wasn't really a man. And then they had a perversion of that. The Christ spirit came on him at his baptism, but when he's hanging on the cross, the Christ spirit leaves him, and he just dies. Because, you know, in Galatians 3, it's quoted from the Old Testament, says, cursed is anyone who does what? Dies on a tree. And of course, a cross is cut from a tree. So these people were saying Jesus is cursed. And Paul said, no. If the person has the Spirit of God, they will not curse Jesus. And if they claim that Jesus is Lord, then they're doing it because they have the Spirit of God. Of course, we're talking about legitimate declarations of who Christ is and who is not. Anybody can open their mouth and say Jesus is Lord. That doesn't mean a whole lot to God, because what did Jesus say in Matthew 7? Many shall come to me and say,
Lord, Lord,
Lord, Lord. And then they'll recite the things that they did. Legitimate things, which, by the way, if you read the context, he does not deny that they did those things. But he said to them this, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. So what they did, while people patted them on the back and congratulated them, he said, no, sorry, it's iniquity. Because if it's not done in the power of the Spirit, And for the glory of God is an unacceptable work to God. And so you'll have people that run around saying, Lord, Lord. But the issue is, do they have a relationship with Christ, with God through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? Paul said, no, the Holy Spirit does not lead anyone to curse Jesus, but to acknowledge him as Lord. But what about you today here at NCBC? Do you acknowledge Jesus as Lord? And if you do, it means you have the Holy Spirit of God. Because only the Spirit of God can enable you to say and mean, and it be genuine, that Jesus is Lord. And of course, we hear Paul's words echoing from Romans chapter 10, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in thy heart that God is raised from the dead, thou shalt be
saved.
Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess
that
Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Is he Lord? And more importantly, is he your Lord? Are you trusting Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Next week, we're going to baptize some folks. And we're baptizing them because they have professed faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. They have acknowledged that they are sinners. They have repented of their sin. And they have received by faith Jesus Christ alone as their Savior. Because salvation is of the Lord. It's not through joining the church. It's not through taking communion. It's not even through getting baptized. Salvation is by trusting Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Agreeing with God that you deserve to go to hell, but that Jesus died for your hell, and you now receive him by faith as your Lord and Savior. And because of that, we're going to baptize some folks next weekend and celebrate with them because they have trusted Jesus as their Lord. My question today to everyone who's here, have you trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? And that's where you're religious. The whole world's religious. That's why we got all of these places of worship. We got about 11 or 12 of them just on Good Luck Road. So we know people are religious. People go to church on a regular basis. But God's never been impressed with religion, because religion didn't die for anybody.
Right.
He sent his son, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. But God demonstrated his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Are you one of the us? That's my concern. And I believe the greatest mission field in America today is the church. Because there are a lot of people who go to church who are religious, who have never accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. They can talk religious talk. They take communion. They get baptized. They serve in the church from pastor down to whatever position you have in the church. But they've never received Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And this is the great deception of Satan today. That you can be religious, and that's all needed. No, you must be. Jesus told Nicodemus, the religious teacher in his day, you must be
born again.
Born from above. Born by the Spirit of God into the family of God. So, do you acknowledge Jesus as Lord? If you do, it means you have the Spirit of God. And the Holy Spirit gives you a spiritual gift of gifts to glorify God through service to others. Now, verses 4 through 6, I'm not going to spend a lot of time there, but just want you to note a couple of things. There is both diversity and sameness in verses 4 through 6. Notice what he says. There are diversities, and your translation may be different. Verse 4 says diversity of gifts. Verse 5 says differences of ministries. And verse 6 says diversities of activities. Actually, in the Greek, the word diversities and difference is the same word. And it means differences. But I don't know why they translated it differently. Notice, there are diversities of what? Gifts, ministries, and activities. God wants unity, not uniformity. And our tendency is to want everybody to be uniform. But God creates diversity. And we're not going to get into the discussion, but that's what he's talking about from verse 12 on to the end of the chapter. Unity and diversity in one body. And we know God creates diversity because when Paul talks about the unity and diversity of body, look, you got two hands, but you don't walk on those. You walk on your two feet. But you don't use your two feet to see because you have two eyes. And you don't use your eyes to hear because you have two ears. And thank God he only gave us one mouth. I know I talk a lot. What about you? All right? But there's diversity, but it's united to work together. It doesn't have to be the same. And what we have to try to not do is to make people over to be exactly like us. Or when they come to the church, you got to dress just like us. You got to sing just like us. No, there's diversity. Listen, there's diversity in music that's God glorifying in the Caucasian community, in the African community, African American community, in the Hispanic community. God doesn't expect us all to sing the same way or only music to be one kind of way. That's trying to bring about uniformity. See, God creates diversity. Accept the diversity that God's created. Don't try to force people into uniformity. And unity grows out of us respecting the diversity that each of us have. And so God gives us different gifts, and no gift is more important than the other. Of course, God's given me a speaking gift. But people who serve are just as important in the church. I'm jumping ahead to 12 to 28. You see? Because each part of your body, you need it to function. Yes. You take your big toe away. Let's see how far you can run. Right? You know? So every part is necessary, but every part is not the same. But there's a tendency to want everything to be the same. Uniformity. God never called for that. He called for unity. Let me get back to where I was. So diversities of gifts, ministries, and activities. That's effects, experiences, actions, deeds, and operations. So different gifts. Different ministries and different activities. Even though we might have the same gift. I have the gift of teaching. Carolyn has the gift of teaching. I know John has the gift of teaching. But John and I don't teach the same way. And so I don't come Wednesday night expecting John to be me. And I'm not looking for him to teach the way I teach. He shouldn't come Sunday when I teach looking for me to teach him. We're diverse. We're different. We have the same gift, and we have it in different proportions and amounts, okay? Sydney and Carolyn can sing, but they don't sing the same. You see? There's diversity in the gifts and even in the ministries that we engage in. We may be involved in the same ministry. As I said, John and I are teaching ministry, but it's different. And there's different degrees and different impacts. That's the activities. But notice, it's the same Spirit, the same Lord, and the same God. So, what did I just say to you? God's a triune God, didn't I? This is one of those Trinitarian passages. Alright? 1 Corinthians 12, 4-6. Who works all in all. Again, different but same because it is God at work in his people. Now in verses 8 through 10, I was trying to alliterate, so I came up with the word denoted. Just another way of saying identify. And what he does in verses 8 through 10 is identify 9 spiritual gifts. Now there are more, rather these are not the only ones in the New Testament. They are also mentioned at the end of this chapter, 1 Corinthians 12 verses 28 to 31, Romans chapter 12, verses 6 through 8. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, and which is very interesting because it's not a gift so much in Ephesians as it is gifted individuals that God gives to the church. Apostles, prophets, pastor teachers, pastors and teachers that he gives to the church. So these are gifted individuals, but they still fall under this discussion of spiritual gifts. And then 1 Peter 4, 10 and 11. Now, Dylan and Toby, I need your help. I started to put this in as an insert, but I figured if I did, you all would be so busy reading it that you wouldn't pay attention to me. I at least wanted you to act like you were paying attention to me. So this is a brief discussion. And the reason I'm giving it to you for two reasons. One, you can't write all these down that fast. Certainly you can underline them in your Bible. But it gives you a brief description, and it gives you some corresponding text to look at in the discussion of the gifts, okay? And that's the major reason I gave it to you. Now, this is D.K. Lowry's, he was the commentator of 1 Corinthians in BKC, which is, Bible Knowledge Commentator, commentary, which was edited by John Walvoord and R.B. Zuck. Of course, John Walvoord was the second president of Dallas Theological Seminary. And he's with the Lord now, but he was president and president emeritus of that theological seminary for many years. And so, this is D.K. Lowry's attempt to discuss these, and I gave it to you so you can look at it, the scripture references, you can study it out, and get some more insight into it. And again, everyone, you have to understand that there are many commentators who vary in their description and understanding of the gifts. But I thought that this was a good starting point for you to have and to be able to use for further study of the gifts. Again, this is such a broad subject. There's so much, and you could take each one of the gifts and just, that's a whole message. But I just wanted to give you this, and you can see, I'll just go through these very briefly. Wisdom refers to insight into doctrinal truth. He says, knowledge refers to the ability to apply doctrinal truth to life. Some would say that knowledge is understanding the Bible and wisdom is applying it. Faith is mentioned here, he states a spiritual gift that is probably an unusual measure of trusting God beyond the exercise of most Christians. So this is separate from the saving faith that you and I all exercise to become Christians, and the faith we, 2 Corinthians 5:7, live by each day. But this is a spiritual gift that a person has the ability to trust God in the most adverse circumstances for things. And so that's why it's given as a gift. Healing is the ability to restore health and also hold off death itself temporarily. Miraculous powers may refer to exercising demons or inducing physical disabilities. What's very interesting about that, Acts 13:11, that's where Paul was confronting that a sorcerer, and the sorcerer, Paul, temporarily blinded the man. That's a very interesting one. And even over death. And of course, this is chapter 5 of Acts, is Peter and Ananias and Sapphira. And remember, Peter's talking to him, and he said, the men at the door, they're gonna bury you. And Ananias dropped down dead. Wife came in 3 hours later, said, did you sell the lamb for money? Well, the men who buried you, you didn't lie to man, you lied to God. She dropped down dead right then as well. That's what that's a reference to. Prophecy is the ability, like that of Old Testament prophet, to declare a message of God for his people. This is one of the gifts, depending on how you define it, would fall either in the temporary gifts or permanent gifts, because most of the time when we think about prophecy, we mostly think about what? Foretelling. But the bulk of prophecy deal with foretelling. God gave a message to the prophet to deliver the people, and it was basically dealing with repentance, and they needed to turn around, not in the future, but right then and there, or God was going to bring judgment on them. And what we do is we proclaim the word of God in that sense. I prophesy because we're telling you what God has said in his word, and God's saying you need to respond to that word right now. But it depends on how you define it. The ability to distinguish between spirits, and I like his definition here, is the gift to differentiate the word of God proclaimed by a true prophet from that of a satanic deceiver. And again, I think this is what Peter exercises in Acts 5, when Ananias and Sapphira came to say, you know, we sold the land for this month. He said, no, you ain't lied to men, you lied to God. Why? No, he said, why has Satan filled your heart lie? He was able to distinguish that what he was saying was a lie. So he was exercising the ability to distinguish between spirits. Now again, this could be something that could be permanent, because even as Christians, if we're not saturated in the truth and really have firm understanding of, there are people that are all around us, false teachers all around that are teaching false doctrine. And there are certain people who are gifted. I think John MacArthur has the gift of distinguishing spirits, because he and some people that work with him, they're able to expose so-called Christian preachers and teachers and show that what they're teaching is contrary to the word of God. But you see, they have spiritual discernment. Well, tongues, the controversial tongues, the ability to speak and unlearn, and please notice the next word, living language. This is not some spiritual, heavenly gibberish that don't nobody know. If you read Acts chapter 2 very carefully, you will see in verse 11 that the people say, we hear them speak in our own languages. The Greek word is glossolalia, and it means languages, real languages. And can't get into 1 Corinthians 14, but people try to pull out of that chapter secret language that only you and God know. And I think they missed the point of it. I think one of the best expositions of 1 Corinthians 14 was by Dr. Thomas Edgar, my former Greek professor. He wrote a book called Miraculous Gifts. And in that book, he discusses 1 Corinthians 14 very detailed, and shows that that's not the intended meaning there. And I've always treasured that book since I got it from him. I've had him autograph it for me over 30 years ago. But it is a great book. And then interpretation was the ability to translate an unlearned, known language expressed in the assembly. I got to say one thing about 1 Corinthians 14. Please go there real quick. This is an aside, but I can't. I need a King James, and I don't. Verse 2, would you read it?
Well, he that speaketh in an unknown tongue.
Thank you. That's all you need to say. He that speaketh in an unknown. Is it italicized?
It is.
Right. Here is one of the times I believe that the interpreters made a mistake by supplying the word. Because the word is, he that speaketh in an unknown tongue. But what most people use when they pull that out is that it's unknowable. So therefore, it's a secret language between you and God. That word unknown is not in the original language. It's not in the Greek text. And that's one place where a supplied word, I think, hurts in trying to understand what the passage is about. And I may say something about that in another message, but I couldn't pass that one up. That's a place where a supplied word hurts, I believe. Using that word unknown, because people take that to mean unknowable. And then they promote this idea that there's this secret language between you and God, so that's why you can have terms as a secret prayer language. And I don't think that's what Paul is talking about there at all. But that's just the kind of an aside. So you have that list, and you can look at that. Let me wrap this up. The last thing I want to emphasize is found verse 7 and 11. So notice verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Verse 7 tells us that spiritual gifts are given to every Christian, And that spiritual gifts are given to every Christian for the profit of all. That is for the benefit of others. Again, spiritual gifts are not for self-aggrandizement, self-promotion. They are always for others, for the profit of others. And verse 11 says, but one and the same Spirit worked of all these things, distributing to each one individually as he will. So you see where I got the third point from, distributed. Verse 11 informs us that all spiritual gifts are distributed by the Holy Spirit. Please note what it says at the end of the verse, as he wills. We do not pick and choose our gift or gifts. The Holy Spirit gives them to us in order that we might do his will, God's will, Christ's will. For they are the triune God. So that will help you when you get to verse 31 of chapter 12. Look at verse 31. And here's where people mis-explain it. But earnestly desire the best gifts. So, I can desire my gift. No, we've just seen back in verse 11, the Spirit of God is the one who gives you the gift. So you don't choose your gift. He's not talking about you being able to choose the gift that you want or the gifts you want, because the Spirit of God is the one who gives them to you. So NCBC, we each have a spiritual gift or gifts. Let's use them to serve one another. Let's use them to do God's will and accomplish his purposes for the church and set forth, that are set forth in his holy word. John MacArthur noted this. When the Spirit of God rules and energizes the church, at least eight evidences will be manifested. The Spirit-controlled church is unified. The Spirit-controlled church is characterized by fellowship. The Spirit-controlled church is worshipful. The Spirit-controlled church is evangelistic. The Spirit-controlled church is loving. The Spirit-controlled church is obedient. The Spirit-controlled church is submissive. And the Spirit-controlled church ministers. Why? Because everyone that's a part of the local church has a spiritual gift or gifts, and they're for the purpose of service. So NCBC, as I close, may that be true of us. For God has given us spiritual gifts to use and serve others and to glorify him. I challenge everyone here today who calls Jesus Christ Lord to use your spiritual gift or gifts for the edification of the saints, the evangelism of the lost, and for the glory of God, the exaltation of Christ, as we depend upon the indwelling Holy Spirit who has given us the gift and will fill us, control us, in order that we might be effective. Amen?
Amen.
God bless you. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the spiritual gifts that you've given to your people. And you expect us to use those gifts to minister to others in the family of God, to reach out to others who are outside the family of God, and to share the gospel with them that they might be saved and become a part of the family of God. Oh Lord, I pray that each one would take seriously their responsibility to serve by using the gift that you've given. In Jesus' name, amen. We want to extend an invitation to you today. Join New Carrollton. We're going to ask you to come forward. Amen. This actually took place a couple weeks ago, but I asked Allie to come forward to the public to let you know that she wants to be a part of New Carrollton Bible Church. Thank you. I was in the wrong place at the wrong time, the wrong church. So Allie, have you trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Okay, you got to say it so those folks over there.
Yes.
Yes, she has. Yes. All right. And you are a candidate for baptism, is that right?
Yes.
Yes. So we thank the Lord for that. We'll quickly talk to her. And come on up here. Don't hide back there.
Amen.
Come on up. Come on up. And you come up too. Come on up. All right. Now, Kirsten is not here, but these four people along with her are the people to be baptized. Obi, his wife, his daughter, and
Julia,
along with Kirsten. So I just wanted to present them to you. So you pray for them this week. Julia said she was nervous, and I told her I'm nervous too. So we'll be nervous together in what I hope will be warm water. And not shivering next week because we're cold. So we're trusting that that'll work out. And so we're excited about next week. Anything you want to say, Owen?
I'm excited. It's been a long time, so this day has finally come, so I'm just anxious to get,
Well, I'm glad you didn't bust me off. Always say, Pastor, when can I get baptized? I need to get baptized right now. I said, well, Owen, give me time. I got to work things up. Pastor, I need to get baptized. If I get baptized, I said, okay, brother. So he was enthusiastic. And you know what blessed my heart? He was a man who wanted to be obedient to God. A man who wanted to be obedient to God. We don't take, ladies and girls, but he's a man who wants to be obedient to God. And I'm telling you, you don't see much of that today. That's why most churches have a majority of women in them, because men aren't stepping up, and men have to step up. And I thank God that Obi's stepping up, and his wife, and his daughter. And you know, it reminds me of Acts 16:31, where Paul said to the Philippian jailer, the Philippian jailer said, what must I do to be saved? Paul said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved and your household. We got a household coming.
Amen.
And we had this is the other part of the household and the son. So we had two households to join Baraka in the New Carrollton. Teresa said she's going to send me back to Baraka. I was excited. To join.
Somebody get the sound and hold it up. They won't forget.
So Lord bless you. You all may go back and see you. We're excited about that. There is comfort in life's darkest tower. There is light and life. There is help and power in the Spirit. In the Spirit of the Lord. Amen. Father in heaven, we thank you for our time here today. I pray that you will bless, that we will take seriously our responsibility to use our spiritual gifts to serve others. And may each member think carefully about that and be active in New Carrollton Bible Church as they minister one to another. We praise you and thank you for those who will be baptized next week. And we thank you for Allie, who's publicly come to acknowledge that she wants to be a part of New Carrollton Bible Church. And we thank you that now, Lord, you've sent two whole families to be part of our local assembly, and we bless and praise you for that.
Amen.
In Jesus' name,
amen.
Amen. God bless you as you go.